We'll start in Acts 19, verse 28. It says, "When they heard this and were filled with rage, they began crying out, saying, 'Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!' The city was filled with the confusion, and they rushed with one accord into the theater, dragging along Gaius and Aristarchus, Paul's traveling companions from Macedonia. And when Paul wanted to go into the assembly with the disciples, they would not let him go. Also some of the Asiarchs, who were friends of his, sent to him repeatedly and urged him not to venture into the theater. So then some were shouting one thing and some another, for the assembly was in confusion, and the majority did not know for what reason they had come together. Some of the crowd concluded it was Alexander, since the Jews had put him forward. And having motioned with his hand, Alexander was intending to make a defense to the assembly. But when they recognized that he was a Jew, a single outcry arose from all of them and shouted for about 2 hours, 'Great is Artemis of the Ephesians! Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!' After quieting the crowd, the town clerk said, 'Men of Ephesus, what man is there, after all, who does not know that the city of the Ephesians is the guardian of the temple of the great Artemis and of the image which fell down from heaven? So since these are undeniable facts, you ought to keep calm and do nothing rash, for you have brought these men here who are neither robbers of the temple nor blasphemers of our goddess. So then, if Demetrius and the craftsmen who are with him have a complaint against any man, the courts are in session and proconsuls are available. Let them bring charges against one another. But if you want anything beyond this, it shall be settled in the lawful assembly. For indeed, we are in danger of being accused of a riot in connection with today's events, since there is no real cause for it, and in this connection we will be unable to account for this disorderly gathering.' After saying this, he dismissed the assembly." Chapter 20, verse 1 ends with this: "After the uproar had ceased, Paul sent for the disciples, and when he had exhorted them and taken his leave, he left to go off to Macedonia." Acts 19:1 says this: "It happened that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul passed through the upper country and came to Ephesus and found some disciples here." Acts 19 presents us several scenes portraying how the gospel impacted this great city of Ephesus. And overall, the impression is that the city is greatly impacted, which we'll find out in just a few minutes. The city was largely impacted already by the occult, by the worship of Artemis, and by magic. But soon Paul would be bringing Christianity with the other disciples to this great city. Ephesus was a major city in Asia Minor, and it actually reached its heyday in the first and second century during Paul's day. It was around in the probably 1100 BC, was actually reconquered by Alexander the Great in the 300s BC, but again reached its heyday in Paul's day. It was actually a huge commercial area and a commercial district, and it was the fourth largest city in Rome at the time, behind only Rome, Alexandria, and probably Antioch. And also became eventually in Paul's day the capital of the province of Asia for Rome. It was actually brought under Roman rule during 133 BC, and it grew really rapidly due to its location. It was actually a major port city. Now the river is silted up, and we're about 5 miles actually from the coast, but it was actually located from the port, but also at the end of the spice and silk trade from Arabia and Asia. The population was estimated to be around 250,000 people during the time of Paul, which is really incredible. We're standing at the site, we're outside the city now, maybe a 5 minutes drive outside of Ephesus, by bus if you will. We're at the Temple of Artemis, the great temple or Temple of Diana, which again was the glory of the city. It was actually one of the seven ancient wonders of the world. It's actually four times the size of the Parthenon in Athens, so it was massive. All we have left is really one column. standing. It would have been richly decorated with the greatest paintings and sculptures of the age, and it actually had 127 columns in all, at a height of 62 feet apiece. There's a picture that we can show of the statue of Artemis that was actually found in the Prytaneum at Ephesus. It was actually 9.5 feet tall, and it dates to the first century AD when Paul was around. This marble statue was probably clothed and adorned with jewelry. And in Greece, Artemis was considered the goddess of chastity and hunting, and was the sister of Apollo. And these are Zeus's children, if you will. And the silversmiths in the city of Ephesus made small images of her that they sold then to the pilgrims that they could then take with them to worship on their own. You'll be able to see on the picture this pair of animals at the base, her feet above them, and the animal, the representations on her dress. Amazing details on this, this with large breasts. They think sometimes, they know they're associated with fertility, but they don't know if there's bee's eggs or bull's testicles, but they're definitely associated with fertility. Paul visited the city of Ephesus on his second and his third missionary journeys, staying probably up to 3 years on his third journey. Ephesus is one of the seven churches, of course, mentioned in the book of Revelation. It's the only church actually mentioned as visited by Paul of those seven churches. Some believe maybe Paul wrote most likely 1 Corinthians, possibly 2 Corinthians, during his three-year stint at Ephesus on the third missionary journey. Some even say possibly Philippians, Colossians, and the book of Philemon.